That, of course, didn't stop Dan, though. He's here with the exclusive story. Dan.
Well, Amma and Larry, the story started when people who work for the county contacted me because they were upset by what happened. I've obtained some graphic and disturbing photos, but you should know the family wants you to see them.
Wendy and Chris Hogan invited me to their son's room at Valley Medical Center to discuss how he wound up in such bad condition.
Are you hurt, Andy?
Last month, 24-year-old Andy refused to take medication for his schizophrenia and suffered delusions. His parents called the county's emergency psychiatric services to place him on a 5150 hold.
We told the EPS that he was going to hurt himself or he was going to hurt us, that he was having delusions. And they said, no, he said he's okay, so they let him go.
It escalated the very next day. His father tells me Andy is warm and affectionate when he's on his meds. Without them, it's a different story.
I told him that I'll take him where he wanted to go in a little bit and just let me get a couple hours of sleep. And then when I was laying there, he reached down and whacked me.
They called the police on me?
Chris called 911 and Andy got arrested on a misdemeanor assault charge. Sheriff's Department sources tell me staff at the main jail's psychiatric unit noted Andy's schizophrenia, but decided he would be fine in Elmwood Jail's general population. Within days, Andy started complaining he's hearing voices, that inmates were out to get him, and he demanded to be transferred back to main jail. In the holding cell that day, Saturday, August 25th, Andy violently banged his head against the wall, but officers took no special precautions. They loaded him in the transport van with leg shackles and a waist chain for his hands. The sources say on the drive, Andy began beating his head against a post inside the van's cage again and again.
I just want to cry. It just makes me sad to think that he went through that and we couldn't help him.
Instead of stopping the van and restraining Andy, sources tell me the officers pleaded with him to stop and called ahead for reinforcements and medical staff to be standing by. But they arrived at the main jail sally port and no one was there. 3 minutes go by until two supervisors arrive, Andy begging for medical help. Their response, according to sources, close the doors, we aren't touching him until fire and EMS get here.
Hey, I'm calling from Santa Clara County Jail. I'm requesting a code 3 ambulance, please.
He was on a boat in the middle of the ocean with nobody to help him. He was there alone. I mean, that's really sad to hear that.
We have an inmate who was banging his head against the cage in the van and now he's bleeding.
Sources tell me it took paramedics 20 minutes to arrive from the time the van got to main jail. They opened the doors to see Andy unconscious, his head dented and split open, his blood covering the walls and floor. I contacted the sheriff's department to confirm what happened, to get the names of the officers involved, to get copies of the body cam videos from that incident, but I didn't hear back, so here I am in San Jose at Evergreen College, hoping to get a comment from the sheriff. I approached Lori Smith before her election debate with challenger John Hirakawa.
So, Sheriff, I need to talk to you about Andrew Hogan.
Who's,
Of the transport on the 25th.
I requested an interview.
Well, as you're leaving, maybe I don't want to bother you before the debate.
Yeah, probably.
Okay, great. Thanks.
As she departed, I tried to ask questions, but her command staff blocked the way.
So, Sheriff, I need to talk to you about Andrew Hogan.
You know, why don't
That's Undersheriff Rick Song. Captain Robert Durr body checked me.
Why are you body checking me?
Why are you pushing?
Who are you?
He wouldn't identify himself. And someone else grabbed me from behind, leaving these scratches and bruises. But I didn't stop.
So I'd like to talk to you maybe tomorrow, on camera, calmly at your desk or something.
Calmly?
Yeah, like a sit-down interview.
My comment will be the same.
Which is what?
That we're looking into it.
Okay, I appreciate your time, man. Thanks very much.
With Andy Hogan's incident, it looks like the sheriff's department will be facing another lawsuit.
They should have transported Andy by medical personnel and not correctional officers.
The Hogans have retained Paula Canny, who represented the family of mentally ill inmate Michael Tyree, beaten to death by three correctional officers. Santa Clara County paid $3.6 million to settle that case. Andy Hogan has suffered a traumatic brain injury. Doctors had to remove the left side of his skull to ease pressure from his brain swelling. He hasn't awoken for a month, doesn't respond to his parents.
I don't know if he knows who I am, or if I don't know anything at this point, but I'm angry, especially hearing what really happened.
I mean, it is completely possible that Andy will spend the rest of his days unable to go to the bathroom, shower, walk, talk, feel, touch, know the experience of life, to just live in a vegetative state, occasionally opening his eyes.
I have filed a Public Records Act request for the radio traffic, the body cameras, and surveillance video from the day that Andy Hogan suffered that terrible injury. I'll keep you up to date, of course.
Yes, Larry, certainly hard to see. Thank you, Dan.
Yeah, I was just wondering, I mean, if her response was, we're looking into it, why the need for the security staff to try to push you away, or you know, why not just do a simple interview?
You know, and I called in advance, and so she knew that I was asking questions, so that's a great question. I mean, there are no wrong questions, right?
Yeah.
Only wrong answers.
Yeah, it's just unfortunate for everybody involved.
Right.
Thank you, Dan.